Children, 3-year-olds, 5-year-olds, elders, 80 and 90-year-olds, women too, all were burned alive.
She ran faster and faster, but they caught up with her. Someone put a gun to her head and pulled the trigger. The mother fell down, blood gushing all over her. She was wounded in the ear, but the bullet only grazed her temple.
They dumped people who were still alive into 20-meter deep wells and then murdered them.
Everywhere in the world, in all cultures, people believe those innocently murdered should be mourned and remembered with respect, while those who killed them in an act of genocide should be condemned and punished.
Seventy years is a lifetime for most people. A lifetime that could be full of events, sad or happy, ups and downs, missed opportunities, and glorious achievements. On the scale of history, however, 70 years is a mere instant. July 2013 marked the 70th anniversary of events whose meaning and significance are still debated in Poland and Ukraine. On April 8, 2013, just before the 70th anniversary of events that split the Ukrainian nation and an ideological standoff, 28 senators representing the Law and Justice Party submitted a draft to the Polish Senate proposing that the 11th of July should be a memorial day in Poland to honor the Polish victims of massacres in Volhynia and other parts of Western Ukraine in World War II. On April the 11th, on the same year, 29 deputies from the Polish People's Party submitted to the lower house of parliament a similar draft entitled On the Genocide Committed by the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists, OUN, and the Ukrainian Insurgent Army, UPA, against Poles on Poland's eastern territories. The key purpose of both of these documents was to recognize the Organization of Ukrainian Nationalists and the Ukrainian Insurgent Army as criminal organizations which, according to the authors of these documents, committed genocide against the Polish population in Western Ukraine. A total of 212 deputies voted in favor of the document that proposed labeling the massacre of Poles in Volhynia the OUN-UPA genocide against Poles, while a total of 222 voted against it. The documents fell 11 votes short of passing, and the issue of genocide was taken off the agenda. The opposition voted to classify the crimes committed by the OUN-UPA as genocide against the Polish population, whereas the ruling party supported a softer wording for foreign policy considerations. It's a well-known fact that the Polish government is actively lobbying Ukraine's integration into the EU. In the end, on July 11, 2013, Poland's parliament approved a statement calling the Volhyn tragedy ethnic cleansing with marks of genocide.
I would like to thank the majority of the parliament, including the Civic Platform Party, and overall everyone who listened to my arguments in favor of classifying the Volhynia tragedy as ethnic cleansing with marks of genocide. And I am glad that the parliament did not fall for emotions or political manipulations.
manipulacjom politycznym i emocjom.
Mnie zdumiało wystąpienie.
I was greatly surprised by Mr. Sikorski's speech, where he said that the use of the word genocide would humiliate the Ukrainians. In my view, it would humiliate the Ukrainian Nazis and nationalists rather than all of the citizens of Ukraine. Mr. Sikorski's argument is both faulty and harmful.
The resolution that does not mention genocide, together with the resolution that does not make the 11th of July a Memorial Day in Poland, are in fact resolutions in support of the Ukrainian nationalists. While what we want is good relations with Ukraine, not with the Ukrainian nationalists. The UPA and the OWN, who committed these atrocities, those crimes of genocide, and that's what our protest is about.
Genocide is genocide, and Poles should never support increasingly vocal opinions that the mass murder of Jews should be considered genocide, while the mass murder of Poles shouldn't.
The Polish parliament, however, rejected the initiative from the opposition to have the Volyn tragedy officially called genocide and to make the 11th of July a memorial day in Poland to honor the memory of those killed in massacres of Poles in Poland's eastern territories, which stirred up a wave of discontent in Polish society.
There's no sense in trying to come up with some convoluted wordings like ethnic cleansing instead of the word genocide. This could lead us to say that the Nazis committed murders with marks of genocide against women too. And this is just unacceptable for any normal, civilized person. To say that I am disappointed is a big understatement. I am extremely irritated. I am furious at the fact that the Polish parliament was even discussing whether it was genocide or not.
Obviously, in this case, we can't talk about genocide, because genocide is first and foremost a national policy supported and promoted by a government. Neither Poland nor Ukraine had a government of their own at the time, since they were under German occupation and after that under the Soviets. Therefore, there was no way genocide could have been committed, either by the Poles or by the Ukrainians.
Poland's print media are leading a somewhat blurred discussion of the subject. The majority of publications are critical over the lack of determination on the part of the Polish authorities on the matter. But there is also a fairly often repeated call to let bygones be bygones and put the case of the Volyn tragedy to rest, at least for now.
We will only be able to get back to the Volynia tragedy when Ukraine becomes a stable and prosperous country within the Western sphere of influence. Trying to address it now would make no sense. Any calls for restoring justice, apologies or compensation will only aggravate our relations with Kyiv at a time when Ukraine's future and its association with the EU are being decided. It would make sense to get back to it in about 20 years, but doing it now would be more than useless. It would be politically damaging. Andrzej Talaga, Genocide is Political Leverage, Rzecz Pospolita, Poland.
When Poland says it was ethnic cleansing with marks of genocide, it is nothing but a softened wording used to keep the peace with the Ukrainians. Because, as you obviously understand, marks of genocide means that it was, in fact, genocide. It was nothing like forced resettlement, like, for example, Operation Vistula, when Poland's Ukrainian minority were moved to the recovered territories. No, it was about physically killing the people off.
This was an attempt to call it genocide directly. But nevertheless, no matter what we call it, there's no bringing these people back. I believe that we must always remember it, that we must learn to live right by using such cases as examples of what's wrong. We need to do our very best to avoid such situations, both in the present and in the future.
On July 14, 2013, the St. Peter and Paul's Cathedral in Lutsk, Western Ukraine, held a memorial service for the victims of the massacres in Volynia. The service was attended by the Polish President, Bronislaw Komorowski, the Ukrainian side was represented by the Deputy Prime Minister, Konstantin Hryshchenko.
It was assumed that since one side is represented by the country's president, the other side would also send its head of state. Sending the Deputy Prime Minister seriously degraded the prestige of the event, even though I personally had the impression that the Deputy Prime Minister was nearly ready to apologize for the absent president, since it was indeed an insult to the head of state.
The Ukrainian parliament gave a curious response to the 70th anniversary of the Volyn tragedy. Nearly one-third of the Supreme Rada, a total of 148 deputies, mostly from the ruling party of regions and communists, signed an official request to the Polish parliament to recognize what happened 70 years ago as genocide against the Polish people. This request triggered a strong response on both sides of the Polish-Ukrainian border. Ukraine slammed the initiative, going so far as to call it treason.
I believe that it was done in protest against the glorification of the Ukrainian nationalist movement and with the purpose of pointing out some serious historical facts that tell us why we have no right to go through with such things in Ukraine. On the other hand, they certainly should all call on the Polish side to condemn the killings of the Ukrainians by the Poles, exactly the way it was presented in the Polish-Ukrainian documents of 2003.
The first attempt to build a bridge between Ukraine and Poland over the disagreements on the Volyn tragedy was undertaken in 23 by the then presidents Leonid Kuchma and Aleksander Kwasniewski. In 2006, the reconciliation process was continued through the efforts of the consecutive presidents Viktor Yushchenko and Lech Kaczynski, who together at a memorial to the Polish and Ukrainian victims of the massacres in Volynia in the village of Pawlowka. It was then that the former president, Yushchenko, said the memorable words, "We forgive and ask for forgiveness." But already in 2008, Roman Shuchevich, leader of the Ukrainian insurgent army, was awarded the title Hero of Ukraine posthumously by Yushchenko.